I actually changed up my talk a little bit this morning because I actually prepared a talk to show you some tidbits of new work that we're now doing in the lab. But then last night during dinner, I heard that maybe it might be better for this audience to basically give a broad overview of where we think we are with microRNAs and how we can therapeutically regulate them. So for the people that are familiar with our work, it's probably going to be a lot of repetition, but please don't hesitate to ask any questions that you might have. And for the people that are not cardiac aficionados, it might actually be new. Yeah, so mending a broken heart, obviously we all want to try to make the heart better by either regulating microRNAs or factors or stem cells. But so one of the focuses for me has been how we can use microRNAs in this aspect. So as a tiny bit of background, so we all know we have a normal heart, and during life your heart is exposed to all kinds of stresses. So you have physiological stresses like either exercise or a pregnancy, which can induce a process which we indicate as physiological hypertrophy. So you probably are all aware that a heart consists of terminally differentiated cells. So upon stress, these cells become enlarged, which we call hypertrophy. And this physiological hypertrophy is actually a reversible process. So what we are more interested in is obviously the pathological stresses. So upon stresses like hypertension or myocardial infarction, your heart becomes exposed to this additional stress and it shows a pathological remodeling process. So this is not only characterized by myocyte hypertrophy, so overgrowth of your cells, but there's also loss of myocytes, fibrosis, so stiffening of your heart muscle. There's a metabolic shift, a reduced cyclic AMP production, and there's also a reactivation of the fetal gene program. This is very interesting aspect, actually, I think, and I'll come back to this a little later because this also appears to be under the control of microRNAs. But suffice it to say that if you have a pathological remodeled heart, the maintenance of additional stress will ultimately lead to heart failure and can induce death. So being in this institute, you're probably all very familiar with microRNA, so I won't go into detail here, but a little bit. So microRNA is transcribed in the nucleus, just like any other gene. It can be intergenic, so coming from an own transcript, or intronic, which means that it's embedded within a coding gene. So whenever this coding gene is expressed, it also gives rise to this microRNA. And then the prime microRNA is cleaved by drosia into a pre-microRNA, which is then exported to the cytoplasm by exporting 5, where it's cleaved by another enzyme, which we call dicer, which forms then the microRNA duplex. So you now have just a double-stranded RNA, which has a microRNA and a microRNA star. And then this is taken up by RISC RNA-induced silencing complex, and then one of the two strands goes on to form the mature microRNA, which binds to recognition sequences that are usually located within the 3' UTR. So here you can simply see an example, so the 3' UTR of a particular gene, in this case IGF-1, and you can see a microRNA binds complementary reverse to these binding sequences. So this is the 5' of your microRNA. This is 3', so it's roughly 20, 21 nucleotides in length. And it's mainly the seed region that's important for target recognition. So the seed region is identified as base 2 to 8, we now think. And this is the key region for recognizing these binding sequences that are located within these target genes. So something that really underscores the biological relevance of these microRNAs for me is that their sequence of the mature microRNA is often 100% conserved across species. So that really states that for the really basic biology, they must have a conserved function across all these species. So already many years back when I went to Dallas for my postdoc, we started asking the question whether microRNAs are also involved in heart disease. So by that time, nobody had studied microRNAs in the heart. It was the first paper had come out that microRNAs were regulated in cancer. So what we did is we simply took two well-defined models of pathological remodeling. So the first one we induced by thoracic aortic bending. So this basically mimics hypertension. So you partially occlude the aorta. So because you are narrowing the aorta, the heart needs to pump against this pressure gradient. And over the course of a couple of weeks, you will get the hypertrophy and the fibrosis that I already alluded to. Another model was the calcineurin transgenic, and I won't go into detail here, but calcineurin is a phosphatase. If you overexpress it only in the cardiomyocytes by using the alpha myosin heavy chain promoter, you will also induce a pathological remodeling response. So what we did is we simply isolated RNA, and we used this RNA for a microarray for microRNAs. So just to tell you how old this story already is, or how rapidly we are progressing in this field, is at this time only 187 microRNAs were plotted on the chip. And by now I think we're, if you want, you can sequence for thousands of microRNAs, although I don't think that they're all relevant for the heart. So it's really evolving really fast. But even with these 187, we could find microRNAs that were either upregulated in both of these disease models or downregulated. And this is just real-time validation of those data. And down here you can see that we were also able to validate these data by Northern blot. So this band is the mature 21 nucleotide mature microRNA. You can see the first lane is a wild type, so a normal heart, and the second lane is a diseased heart. And here you can see that all these microRNAs are nicely induced, and these are downregulated in the diseased hearts. So obviously, we're not only interested in mice, but also what these microRNAs do in human. So although these are very different samples, we, from the group from Mike Bristow, we actually obtained some samples of normal hearts and failing hearts. And these are idiopathic samples, so we don't know what these patients are, why they are sick. But they do have heart failure. And you can see for some of the microRNAs that we saw upregulated in these mouse disease models, we could also determine them to be upregulated in human samples. Something that really was striking to me is the level of regulation. So if you look at classical heart failure markers like ANF or BNP, you can see a strong, very strong induction. But the level of regulation is very variable. This is different for microRNA somehow. So although they're only regulated like threefold maybe in a diseased heart, the level of regulation is very consistent. So this might actually imply that they're fairly high upstream. But so being in Eric Olsen's lab, what we do a lot there, or what we did a lot, at least I did, he's still doing it, is make use of mouse genetics. So we started overexpressing some of these microRNAs and also genetically deleting some of these microRNAs in the heart. In this particular case, we again made use of the cardiac-specific promoter, the alpha myosin heavy chain promoter, to overexpress microRNA 195. And based on the level of overexpression, we could see that only increasing the level of this specific microRNA was sufficient to induce pathological remodeling in the heart. So of course you might wonder, yeah, how much are you increasing your microRNA? Because in humans we only see a threefold induction, and we were increasing it higher. But this effect is not just due to overloading the processing system of these microRNAs, because we made many different transgenics models that didn't show us a phenotype. So it's really due to the function of microRNA 195 that these hearts became sick. So one of the focuses right now in our lab is ischemic heart disease. And this is also, of course, a key focus in some of the labs here. So a little bit, tiny bit of background. So ischemic heart disease is a very important disease. And it's all caused by an insufficient amount of blood that's being supplied to the heart. So you get an infarct, and because the part of the left ventricle is not supplied by blood anymore, it actually starts to die off. While a normal adult human heart roughly has 5 billion myocytes, during an average site infarct, roughly 20% of these cells are lost. And normally, when you have a wound or a scar, the neighboring cells will start to divide and the wound will simply heal. But because most myocytes, and almost all of them, are terminally differentiated, the heart has a very poor regenerative capacity. So basically, what's gone is gone, and it's not very well replenished. So also for this particular disease indication, we were wondering whether microRNAs were involved. So again, we make use of a mouse model that mimics a myocardial infarction. So you can occlude the left coronary ascending. Then part of the heart actually dies over the course of time. You can see that there's an infarcted region. And 2 weeks after you induce this infarct, there's a very thin infarcted region, and in the border zone region, that's the region flanking the infarct, there's a lot of remodeling. So you get the cardiomyocyte hypertrophy, so enlargement of the heart muscle cells, and in blue you can see that there's fibrosis, so there's really stiffening of the heart muscle. So we again found overlappingly up and down regulated microRNAs both 3 and 14 days after infarct. And among these microRNAs, we found microRNA 15B. So why was this interesting? Well, I just spoke to you about microRNA 195. Well, microRNA 15B actually turns out to be part of the same microRNA family. And a microRNA family is defined as a set of microRNAs that have a comparable seed region. So I told you that the seed region is the predominant region in a microRNA that actually is responsible for target recognition. So presumably, because a microRNA family has the same seed sequence, they can all target the same mRNA targets. So microRNA 15B and let's see here, and microRNA 195, they both have the same seed region, and they're also expressed, the whole family itself is expressed as 3 bicistronic clusters. So all 3 transcripts are giving rise to 2 different microRNAs. So because we knew that 15B was going up in a mouse model of myocardial infarction, we also checked the expression of this whole family in a porcine, so in a pig model of myocardial infarction. And we could nicely see that in light blue, that's the infarcted region, compared to sham, which is the darker blue bar or the black bar, I can't really see. You can see that all these 15 members are strongly induced. So it's not a mouse phenomenon, but we can also repeat it in pigs. And when we then again look in these human samples, you can see that it's not only microRNA 15 and 195 that's induced in human heart failure, but also 16. So what we're dealing with, and this is one of the things why microRNAs are so powerful, the genome often contains multiple copies of basically the same microRNA, or at least we think it can function in a comparable manner, and they're all induced in response to a certain stress. So basically, the system is activated and then starts activating 6 different microRNAs, which basically all should have the same outcome. So it provides a lot of potency to these microRNAs. So while we were doing these experiments, Enzo Porello, who was a postdoc in Eric's lab, also did a subset of experiments. So I told you that an adult heart does no longer regenerate, or at least the regenerative capacity is very low. However, in this particular case, you're looking at a neonatal pup, so 1 day after birth. And if you then amputate the apical region of this heart, so you can basically just chop it off with a tiny blade. If you chop this region of the heart off, 1 day later, you'll see that indeed the ventricle, you have a 15% loss of the ventricle in these neonatal pups. However, 3 weeks later, this damage is completely restored. So unlike an adult heart, a neonatal heart can actually still recover from this damage. So and this is what's going on. So initially you have clot formation, obviously, because all the blood would leak out. Then there's an inflammatory response. Myocytes actually start to proliferate, something that we don't see in an adult heart, or it's not very profound. And 3 weeks later, it's completely gone and completely normal. So okay, what's the difference then? So why can a P1 heart, so 1 day after birth, still regenerate and these myocytes still proliferate? And why can a P10 heart not? So we again profiled for microRNAs that might be relevant here. And again, we saw that while the microRNA 15 family is low in these P1 and P3 heart, it's actually inducing all these family members at P10. So maybe the increase of the microRNA 15 family is actually repressing this proliferative capacity. So that was our question. So is maybe microRNA 15 involved in the fact that in a neonatal heart, myocytes can still divide and form new myocytes, while in an adult heart, this capacity is fairly low. So I told you that a microRNA functions by the regulation of mRNA, so the downstream target. So that's really how a microRNA function is defined, right? By which mRNAs, to which mRNAs it can bind. So if you then look at these bioinformatic target prediction programs that you can simply find online, you can very clearly see that this microRNA family has a preference for targeting genes that are involved in cell proliferation, cell survival, and cell cycle. So like the cyclins and all these other genes. So the ones indicated in blue are actually genes that have been validated to be microRNA 15 targets. And this is actually a larger number by now. So what this all led to, it led us to conclude that upon stress, like for example a myocardial infarction, the microRNA 15 family members go up, thereby you get a steeper repression of your target genes and actually have a loss of myocytes and cell cycle. So that might also be the difference between a neonatal myocyte and an adult myocyte, right? In neonatal myocytes, you have very low levels of the 15 family members, in adults higher, and it represses all these cell cycle genes. So obviously, it will be very interesting to see what inhibition does. But I'll come back to that in a little bit. Just to show you as an example that microRNAs are not only upregulated, we also found in the same screening for microRNAs involved in remodeling of the heart after myocardial infarction, we also found this particular microRNA, microRNA 29. It's also part of a family, and you can see that in response to myocardial infarction, the mature microRNA and also its premier, it's decreased in the border zone after infarct compared to a sham-operated heart, so a mimic surgery. And in the remote myocardium, 29 is up again, and we can validate these data by real-time PCR. So I told you microRNA 29, also a family. In this particular case, two bicistronic clusters giving rise to two microRNAs. So in total, the genome has four different copies of 29. If you look at the predicted targets here, it's all these extracellular matrix-related genes. And these are not just predicted targets, these have all been validated in vivo. And I think that microRNA 29 is actually the nicest microRNA to work with so far, because the microRNA field, and it hurts me to tell you this, but has become a little bit polluted by a lot of stories that say that a certain microRNA has a certain function, and people are dispute each other's stories. And that's of course a problem, right? If there's not a clear message. But that's not true for this particular microRNA, I'm happy to tell you, because everybody's convinced that this microRNA is very strongly involved in fibrosis. So obviously, that would mean that if you can increase a microRNA 29 and thereby lower all these, the expression of all these extracellular matrix-related genes, you might actually be able to envision that it might have a potential application in fibrotic diseases like liver fibrosis or lung fibrosis. Decreasing 29 would actually stiffen a tissue and could have a potential implication in an aneurysm. So to make a very long and elaborate story relatively short, I think what we now know is that microRNAs are involved in heart disease. They regulate different aspects of heart disease. Excuse me. So while we think that 15 is involved in cell cycle and survival, 29 is, for example, involved in fibrosis. I think they have a lot of power because the genome contains often multiple copies that are regulated in a comparable manner. And at the same time, as I also showed you, that a microRNA or a microRNA family often targets genes that are involved in a comparable cellular process or signaling cascade. So 29 is involved in fibrosis, no doubt. 15 is involved in cell cycle and cell survival. And I think this is a common theme among a lot of the microRNAs, and that's what makes them powerful, because you can imagine that although the direct changes of a microRNA it has on an mRNA are very small, it's really the combined effect of all these small changes that apparently can have a very strong downstream effect on a cellular process. So what really stimulated this field is things that we already learned from siRNAs. So based on lessons learned from siRNA, we relatively easily can manipulate microRNAs. So this is again the pathway that I already alluded to. You can add a microRNA inhibitor, which is basically simply a single-stranded oligo, complementary reverse to your microRNA of interest. It will only bind to your microRNA of interest, and by binding to it, it will prevent it from functioning as microRNA, the resultant being that you get an increase of the genes that are normally targeted by this microRNA. Conversely, there's a microRNA mimic. This is actually, this field is lagging a little bit, but I'll still show you an example in a couple of minutes. So this is a double-stranded oligo. Because it's double-stranded, you need to conjugate it to a cholesterol or another lipid to get it across the cell membrane. But if you introduce it within a cell, it actually will take over the microRNA function. It will function as a microRNA, and it will depress the target genes. You can imagine that this inhibitor will only work in the cells where your microRNA is expressed, right? Because else it will not bind to anything and it won't have a function. While this approach actually is a lot less clean, because if you deliver it systemically, it will go into all cell types that it sees, and you're also introducing this microRNA then in cell types that have never seen this microRNA, so the chance of off-target effect is far greater than with an enteromere. So with the more broadly expressed microRNAs, this might be a better approach than with the more specifically expressed microRNAs. So what, as Mauro already alluded to, back in 2007, I was in Dallas for 2 years, and based on the excitement around microRNAs and the data that we obtained and the fact that I was in a lab with Eric Olson, who is very entrepreneurial and he likes to undertake new things like starting companies. We decided in 2007 to start a company, and it was a very interesting period for me, because I came from Holland. I went to do a postdoc, and then 2 years later we had some data and some patents were filed, and then okay, let's start a company. Sure. So it was just me and Bill Marshall at that time who had signed on. But then I was so surprised to learn that a couple months later it was already mentioned in Science that there was this new company. And at that time it was just me and Bill that had decided to actually become part of the company. And obviously Eric also. But it became a very big success, because, or at least we hope it will, but it still is going strong. But so we started off with a couple of people. We grew out to a team of 40. And then a couple years ago, Servier actually partnered with us, because they believed in the initiative. And obviously, as long as you're not in the clinic, these companies only cost money, and a lot of money. And especially if you want to start doing clinical trials, you need to be backed up by people with very deep pockets. And Servier is a French company, and they have very deep pockets. So they decided to financially support the effort. And it's all still going really well. But at that point, it became less interesting for me, because they really want to develop this stuff into the clinic. And I'm not a drug developer. I'm a basic scientist. So that's also one of the reasons why I thought it would be good for me to take a step back and do what I really am excited about and what I think I'm better at, and just keep my ties to the company, so I still get the positive things and remain involved while doing the nice experiments back at the bench again. Anyway, so at Mirogen, I started off by testing all these different chemistries that could target microRNA. So these anti-mirrors, as I told you, so this is the microRNA, one of our key microRNAs that we want to target. It's microRNA 208. There's already many different chemistries out there that can all target your microRNA. So you can simply dissolve them in some physiological salt, saline, and systemically deliver them. They will find the microRNA that you designed your anti-mirror to, bind to the microRNA so it can no longer function. The entagomere is the full-length complementary reverse. It has cholesterol conjugated to it. So if people talk to you about an entagomere, they should be talking about the cholesterol conjugated one, but there's a little bit of a confusion in the field. So people actually use entagomere for the anti-mirrors in general. However, there's also shorter chemistries, and the shorter chemistries are actually LNA modified. So LNA is locked nucleic acid. It's an RNA analog, and it increases the binding affinity to these microRNAs, and that's why you can get away by using shorter oligos. So this oligo will bind to your microRNA of interest. As you can see, there's a couple of LNAs, and it's an LNA-DNA mixmer, as we call it. So the purple bases are still DNA. And what's interesting about these LNA-modified oligos is you can use lower doses, which is good, but you can go as short as an eightmer. So for all of you who have ever designed a primer, it's that simple. So you just design a very tiny fragment of these LNA-modified anti-mirrors. And I told you that the seed region is mainly important for target recognition, but these families, the sequence often differs outside of the seed region. So these tiny mers are perfect if you want to target the whole family, because then you don't need to design all kinds of different anti-mers to target all the different family members. So that's what we did for the microRNA 15 family, and I think I already gave it away there. But so all the different families, we used the entagomere, the LNA-DNA mixmer, so the 16 mers, 16 different bases, and tiny, as we call it, which is directed against the seed. So this is just a dose response curve, injecting increasing amount of these different chemistries, so ranging from 0.033 megakick up to 33 megakick, collecting cardiac tissue a week later. At this time, we were still injecting IV. We now know that that's not necessary. Sub-Q injection is just fine. And you can see that all these chemistries were able to inhibit or lower 15B levels in the heart. Entagomere, the least efficient. The LNA-DNA, very efficient. And tiny, a little bit less. But we now know that's because it's not only targeting microRNA 15B, but it's also targeting all the other family members, while this guy is not. So it's just sponged away by the different family members. So we took this in a mouse model of ischemic injury. And so what you're looking at here is, in pink, is the area at risk after you infarct these animals. In white, it's actually the infarcted region. And you can see that if you inject animals with saline, anti-mir 15, or the control, the area at risk is basically the same. So they're exposing them to the same, a comparable kind of stress. But the infarct is strongly reduced when you block microRNA 15. So here you can see this is the infarcted area, which is lower in the tiny 15B treated animals. You can see that 15 is indeed inhibited, and this also translates into a reduction in left ventricular and diastolic pressure, which is basically a functional readout for the damage that you induced. We injected it directly after infarction, but when we then look at fibrosis 2 weeks later, which is, I think, of course, secondary to the infarct that you're inducing, you can see that inhibition of 15 also lowers the fibrotic area in these animals. And this also translates into an improvement in cardiac function. So ejection fraction is the measure of the contractility of the heart, which is improved after inhibition of 15, and also the volumes of your left ventricle. So you can imagine that if you have a dilated ventricle, the volumes are larger, which is indeed true after an infarct. These are blunted by the tiny 15. I think I'm losing my pointer here. There you go. Inhibition of 15 indeed appears to be a good thing after ischemia. So I told you, conversely, you can also increase the level of a microRNA. So for this particular case, we used a microRNA mimic. There's probably no surprise if we used a mimic for microRNA 29 at first. So the double-stranded oligo, so this is the strand that goes on to form your mature microRNA. This strand, the cholesterol conjugated strand, is the strand that should be degraded in vivo. When you make these mimics, make sure that you add in a couple of mismatches in the sense strand, because actually you're not only putting in a microRNA, but also the inhibitor at the same time. So that would not be a good thing. So make it so that it's not an inhibitor. Of course, if you're in a company, you can have a lot made because you need a lot of these mimics. You cannot stabilize them as much as an entimer. So these mimics are going to be very rapidly degraded in vivo. So, and that's also what we see. So here we are injecting increasing amounts of mimic going up to 125 mg a kick, which is really, really a lot. But if you then look in the different tissues, and that's also something that I already told you, you're not only increasing the microRNA in your target tissue, but you're actually increasing it in all kinds of tissues, and somehow it preferentially delivers to the lung. We don't know why, but in this particular case, for this mimic, it actually appears to do so. We can increase it in the other tissues, but not as well as in the liver, lung. So timing-wise, entimers are super stable. You inject them and they will inhibit your microRNAs for weeks. How that's possible, we're still trying to figure out. So I actually think that it's being captured in some kind of endosomal reservoir, and then in time it's trickled out to inhibit your microRNA. But as you can see here, these microRNA mimics are only active for a couple of days at best. So 4 days, and then mainly in the spleen, you can still see an increase. So that means we need a lot, and we need to dose it very often. But because it delivered to the lung, we thought, okay, let's try this in a therapeutic model. So here you can see the 29 also in patients with pulmonary fibrosis, 29 is decreased. Just like in the heart, when you give an infarct and there's a lot of fibrosis, we also see a lowering of 29. And then when we give mice that are exposed to gliomycin, which induces pulmonary fibrosis, when we treat these animals with a microRNA 29 mimic, this fibrotic response is blunted, at least. So also in an already diseased animal, so give them gliomycin, let the pulmonary fibrosis develop, and then treat them with the microRNA mimic. We can also partially reverse it by putting in the mimic. So here you can see hydroxyproline is basically a readout for collagen deposition, is brought back to almost normal when we treat them with a mimic. And collagen 1 and collagen 3 expression is also blunted. So I told you that delivery will be key for these therapeutics, just for the sake of the off-target effects. So what we're now trying to do is use a delivery vehicle just like a hydrogel. So in this particular case, I'm showing you a pH-sensitive UP hydrogel. I'm not a chemist, so you guys know as much about this as I do. But apparently this is a pH-sensitive gel that if you inject it at a pH that's lower than 8.5, so basically in your heart muscle. So normally it's just a solution. As soon as it touches your heart, it will gelize and just sit there. And then it will slowly degrade its and release its content. So what colleagues of mine did is they used this gel in a pig model of myocardial infarction to release growth factors like IGF and HGF. And so what they did is they used an endocardial catheter to inject it in 10 single injections around the infarcted area that they can trace, and it actually does seem to work. But the most important thing for me here is not the IGF part, but the fact that you can use this gel to release something locally in the heart, so you can try to shoot for a burst of release of your microRNA therapeutics, and you can also hopefully prevent some of the side effects in tissues where these anti-mirrors or these microRNA mimics normally end up in. So that's really what we're hoping for. So we're just trying to optimize the release kinetics for these hydrogels now for a microRNA mimic. And what's interesting is you can look at a microRNA, see how it functions, and then you can determine, okay, I want to have it released for 4 days. Now modify my hydrogel as such that it will release all the contents over the course of 4 days. So here you can see three different gels with three different UPI constitutions. And then you can see you can actually indeed determine the release profile of the microRNA therapeutics coming out of the gel. Excuse me. So to summarize this first part, and don't worry, the second part is not as long. But I think microRNAs are very relevant. They are conserved across species. MicroRNA therapeutics do work. The therapeutics show broad distribution pattern, so delivery will be key. So I just want to give you some examples of things that we have learned over the course of the last couple of years in doing these experiments. And I want to do that based on one of the microRNAs that I've spent a lot of time on. So this microRNA relates to alpha and beta myosin heavy chain. So a heart muscle cell gets its contractility from the myosin heavy chain genes. There's two main myosin heavy chain genes in the heart, which are alpha and beta myosin heavy chain. And these two genes are in balance with each other. So whenever alpha goes up, beta goes down, and the other way around. So under stress conditions, there is a shift from alpha towards beta. While in a mouse heart, alpha is predominant and beta is then really increased a lot, in a human and non-human primates heart, beta is the predominant myosin, but still during stress, there is a shift towards beta myosin heavy chain. And this is important because beta myosin heavy chain is the slower contracting myosin, and it's actually thought to be a pathological myosin change. So a shift towards beta is thought to be detrimental for heart contraction. So we figured out that intronically alpha myosin heavy chain contains a microRNA which we know as microRNA 208. So whenever alpha myosin heavy chain is expressed, and because it's only expressed in the heart muscle cell, it will give rise to microRNA 208 and thereby makes microRNA cardiomyocyte specific. So as you can see here on this multiple tissue, 208 is only expressed in the heart. There's a trace of expression in the lung which comes from the pulmonary myocardium, which is a couple of residual cells that we can find there. That's very interesting because that makes microRNA 208 the only cardiac specific microRNA that we know so far. And here you can see that we were able to genetically delete this microRNA. we could take it from the genome and thereby making sure that we left alpha myosin heavy chain intact, because you don't want to mess with a contractile protein that's so important for the heart. So at first we were very disappointed because this was the first genetic deletion of a microRNA that had been made ever. And we were like really hoping that microRNAs were going to be super important. So if we took it away, these animals would die. Well, that didn't turn out to be the case. So these this knockout animal was healthy and viable and fertile. So it appeared completely normal. So we were actually a little bit disappointed and thinking, okay, well, maybe they are the moderate regulators that we know microRNAs can be. So I told you that the individual changes are very small. So, but because the alpha-beta switching is so important for cardiac stress, we decided to stress these animals, again making use of the transverse aortic banding, so tying off the aorta partially. And you can see that a wild-type animal actually responds with the pathological remodeling, as we spoke about already. And in the microRNA 208 knockout animals, these animals were resistant against this stress. So there was little hypertrophy or fibrosis going on. But the main important molecular change that we could observe is, I told you during stress, there's an induction of the pathological beta myosin heavy chain. This induction was absent in the 208 knockout animals. So deleting this tiny piece of RNA could completely block the stress-induced induction of beta myosin heavy chain, this incredibly important, incredibly big contractile gene in the heart. So there's nothing moderate about the regulation of this gene. So under stress conditions, it might be that microRNAs are way more important. So the moderate changes are now actually translating into a very profound downstream effect. And we could also confirm this on RNA. We did a lot of studies. TRAP turned out to be one of the target genes, so thyroid receptor-associated protein. It has multiple binding sites that are conserved in the UTR. I think the presence of multiple binding sites in the UTR might give you a hint that there is a relation between that gene and your microRNA. And we could see it increased in the 208 knockout animals. But then follow-up studies showed us that there's actually a whole subset of transcriptional repressors that's responsible for the block of pathological remodeling and the beta response. So at Mirogen, this was actually what triggered Mirogen 208 being so cardiac specific and having such a profound effect during cardiac remodeling. So the anti-mers, we again use the RNA-DNA mixmer. You inject 3 times 3 mg a kick at day 1, 2, 3. I told you these things are very long-lasting. So even 6 weeks later, we still see an almost complete inhibition of microRNA 208 levels in the heart, which means that they must be very stable. And it also means that these new copies of 208 that are being produced by alpha myosin heavy chain must somehow be blocked by a reservoir of these anti-mer that remains present in the cell. So that's still very interesting. So I told you if you genetically delete 208, I showed you there's a block on beta myosin heavy chain. And while we get an immediate inhibition of 208, the downstream effect on beta myosin heavy chain actually requires a couple of weeks. So for some microRNAs to see the downstream effect, you need to inhibit this microRNA for a prolonged period of time. So I told you we can target the heart with these anti-mers, and this is just measuring the presence of the anti-mer in the different tissues. So this is 1 week after we inject them. We are targeting the heart, but we're targeting the kidney and the liver way harder. So again, delivery is something you want to contemplate, especially for the more broadly expressed microRNAs. And this remains the same over time. So again, showing you how stable they are. I told you we can deliver them IP, but IP and sub-Q does the trick as well. I won't go into detail for the sake of time, but blocking microRNA 208 with this anti-mer can block the pathological remodeling as indicated here and by histology, and also revert the shift, the reduction in alpha back to normal and the increase in beta back to normal. So we now have a drug that actually can recapitulate what we saw in the genetic deletion model, block the hypertrophic response, fibrosis, and regulate the shift in alpha and beta. So that's great. Here we put animals on a high salt diet for 8 weeks, so when or 9 weeks when they're already sick, and then start treating them. And even at that point, inhibition of 208 is actually extending their lifespan. So, and here are the last couple of slides, and this is something that we've learned, and it really complicates the people, the lives of people that are working on microRNAs, I think. So what we did here is a regular gene array after we treated these animals for 8 weeks with anti-mer 208, so 4 doses. So every 2 weeks they get an injection. If we then look at the direct 208 targets, what's good is that the saline groups, they cluster very nicely with the control oligo. And the control oligo is exactly the same chemistry, but it's directed against a C. elegans expressed microRNA. So basically the same chemical composition, but having no effect. You can see anti-mer 208 nicely clusters together. But the level of target regulation and dynein light chain and VCPRP under these stress conditions, so this is the hypertensive rat model, you can see a maximum of 2-fold. And that's max for these targets. So it's really something that you have to be aware of when you do these studies. So the targets that we defined in the genetic model, we didn't even see on the gene array. So even a gene array is not sensitive enough to pick up the target genes of a microRNA when you inhibit it for such a long time. But then when we look by real time and compare the high salt, so the diseased group, to the diseased group with an anti-mer 208, you can see that all these targets are de-repressed, so increased after we inhibit the microRNA, but the effect is just so small that even a microarray will not pick it up. So if you want to look for microRNA targets, gene array might just be the best way to go. Then also, when we found dynein light chain and VCPIP in the hypertensive rat model as two of the key targets under stress of 208. So then we started figuring out the kinetics of the regulation of these genes in wild-type animals, so in unstressed animals. And we saw a nice effect on dynein light chain derepression just under basal conditions. But while dynein light chain or VCPIP was regulated under stress conditions, under baseline homeostatic conditions, this gene was not regulated. So this means that target regulation on the basal condition of a microRNA, it will regulate certain targets. However, under stress conditions, there is more targets that are regulated, and also, as I'll come back to later, the level of target regulation is more pronounced. So studying the function of a microRNA, you can only do under stress conditions, under the stress conditions that you're interested in. So the level of stress, so in an infarct model, you can imagine that the infarcted region is really the most stressed region, right? There's a lot going on, and then you get the border zone and a remote and the right ventricle actually stay behind a little bit. If you look at the effect of anti-miR 208, you can see that it's most pronounced in the region that's most stressed. So the more stressed a tissue becomes, the more effect inhibition of your microRNA has. So that's also something you want to think about when you study these things. So, and then under, for example, after a myocardial infarction, we've looked at 208 targets, and then we find a subset of targets. However, when we then stress the system by, for example, making these animals obese, so the gene expression profile of the heart is very different than after a myocardial infarction, this microRNA also starts to regulate different targets. So it's not only the presence of stress that's going to determine the function of your microRNA, but also the type of stress you are exposing your tissue of interest to. So this is basically what I already mentioned. And then, of course, I told you that the sequence of microRNA is often 100% conserved, which is great, but as you probably also know, the 3' UTR sequence of genes can be very different. So that means that the binding of a microRNA in a mouse to certain mRNAs might not be conserved in humans, although, as it turns out to be, the most key genes that are regulated are actually conserved across species. And that's obviously also something we need by translating mouse findings into the clinic. So luckily, there's a couple of really nice examples of this. So the group of Stephanie Dimler, I think in 2009, they published this in Nature, that the microRNA 92A can increase angiogenesis. And last year, we, in collaboration with her and Rabea Hinkel, we actually repeated this in a porcine model, also showing that the same targets were regulated. We can reduce infarct size, just like they showed in mice, in pigs now. And this also translates to a benefit in a function. People that are aware of this field probably also saw this New England paper in 2013, where Centeris, who also uses the LNA-DNA mixmer, so against a liver-expressed microRNA 122 that's involved in HCV, and they showed that 4 weeks dosing of miraversin, as they call it, so that's the anti-miR 122, actually lowers HCV expression in these patients, and even after they stop dosing, they can see a prolonged effect, and it actually reverts back to normal later on. So it's reversible, but it's also maintained after you stop, and that's basically what we saw with 208 inhibition, where it just requires a very long time to get the maximum effect. And then obviously companies are very keen on translating this, so Regulus is really moving forward very quickly in different kind of areas with anti-miR therapies, and also Mirogen is trying to do the same thing, of course. And this is a Houston-based company, Myrna. They're trying to develop microRNA mimics for cancer. So I'd like to end with all the things I just mentioned, so that the function of a microRNA is dependent on the presence of stress, the level of stress, the type of stress. So if you think about the clinical application there, it's going to be best if our patient population has a disease due to a specific disease driver. Because the more heterogeneous your disease population is, the more the gene expression levels in these hearts are going to differ, so your microRNA might have a different function. It's just something that we are obviously struggling with. The sequence is conserved, but the UTR sequences might just not be. And microRNA therapeutics are moving forward in the clinic for several indications, and obviously I'm a very big proponent of them becoming a novel therapy for heart disease. And well, we're on the way, and the future will tell whether that's actually going to happen. So I want to end with this slide. So a lot of this work was done while I was still in Dallas and at Merigen, but I hope I kind of gave you an overview of where the field is and what we're thinking. Currently in the lab, we're very keen on identifying potential new microRNAs that might be relevant for heart regeneration, and also the hydrogel delivery, the UpiGel delivery method is something that we're interested in. So we're lucky enough to get some sponsoring. As Mauro already said, we have the Leduc grant. So these are several of the people, and I welcome anybody to the lab that is willing to move to Holland, but coming from here, that might actually be not very attractive. But so thank you, and if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.